ഹലോ നമ്മൾ സ്റ്റാർട്ട് ചെയ്യല്ലേ ഹലോ ഡോക്ടർ രമ്യ
സർ
സ്റ്റാർട്ട് ചെയ്യല്ലേ
സർ
ഓൾറെഡി 10 മിനിറ്റ്സ് കഴിഞ്ഞു ഗുഡ് ഈവനിങ് ഓൾ വെൽക്കം ടു ടുഡേയ്സ് മീറ്റിംഗ് ഓഫ് പെരിന്തൽമണ്ണ ONG സൊസൈറ്റി which has been sponsored by Aster MIMS Hospital, Kottakkal. Today's CME is on adolescent gynecology, and that subject altogether, it needs a lot of discussions, and it has been least discussed topic in many of the conferences. And today's highlight is that we'll be discussing two most important aspects of adolescent gynecology. One is the evaluation and management of primary amenorrhea, and also an update on HPV vaccines. And Aster MIMS Kottakkal has been very much encouraging and supportive in the activities of Perinthalmanna ONG Society. All this since the beginning of our society, the members from the Aster MIMS Kottakkal have supported all the activities of the society to a great extent. They have been participating in all our community activities, CSR activities, as well as the academic programs. Today with us to talk to you on clinical approach to the primary amenorrhea, we have Dr. Sajana Thayil, who is the senior consultant in obstetrics and gynecology at Aster MIMS Hospital, Kottakkal. And Dr. Sajana has many years of experience in the practice of high-risk pregnancy and gynecology and endoscopy. And she has been serving for many years in many hospitals in Malappuram district. And now she has joined the prestigious Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at Aster MIMS Kottakkal. With these few words, I invite Dr. Sajana Thayil to deliver the talk on primary amenorrhea. Over to Dr. Sajana.
Good evening. First of all, I thank POGS organizers for giving me such an opportunity. And today I'm going to discuss about primary amenorrhea. And as you all know, primary amenorrhea is defined as the absence of menstruation by the age of 15 years in presence of sexual secondary sexual characters, or by the age of 13 years in the absence of secondary sexual characters. And these are the normal sequence of events taking place at puberty. It starts with breast development by the age of 9 years, and almost all this development is completed by the age of 15 years. And considering the development of secondary sexual characters, estrogen is responsible for the development of breast and female voice, whereas androgen, adrenal androgen, is responsible for the development of axillary and pubic hair. And these are the five basic factors involved in the onset and continuation of normal menstruation, which include a normal female karyotype, coordinated hypothalamo-pituitary-ovarian axis, anatomic presence and patency of outflow tract, responsive endometrium, and active support of thyroid and adrenal glands. And actually, amenorrhea is just a symptom. It is not a diagnosis. And we have to arrive at the diagnosis. And here the problem can be either endocrinologic or embryologic, with or without secondary sexual characters and with or without female internal genitalia. So the causes can be at any of the following level. It can be hypothalamic, anterior pituitary, ovaries, or at the level of outflow tract. As you all know, hypothalamus secretes gonadotropin-releasing hormone, which acts on the anterior pituitary to produce FSH and LH. So when the problem is at the level of hypothalamus or anterior pituitary, the gonadotropin levels are low. Hence, it is called hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. And when the ovaries are the culprit, estrogen and progesterone secretion is decreased. And since there is no negative feedback, the gonadotropin levels are very high. And it is called hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. And when the problem is at the level of outflow tract, usually all these hormone levels will be normal, and hence it is called normogonadotropic normogonadism. And first we'll highlight the causes of hypothalamic and pituitary causes. And this accounts for about 25% of all primary amenorrhea. 20% are hypothalamic and 5% pituitary causes. Here, the FSH and LH level will be less than 5 international units. And the most common cause is constitutional delay. And Kallmann syndrome is the second most common cause. Also, CNS tumors, anorexia nervosa, excessive exercise and weight loss, chronic diseases, neoplasia, infiltrative disorders of CNS, all this can cause primary amenorrhea when this happens before puberty. Also, hypothyroidism, polycystic ovarian disease, Cushing syndrome, and hyperprolactinemia, though they usually cause secondary amenorrhea, they can also cause primary amenorrhea. And consider the constitutional delay. This is the most common cause of hypothalamic hypomenorrhea. And here, this is due to delayed reactivation of gonadotropin-releasing hormone pulse generator. And this is the most common type of hypothalamic amenorrhea, and it is account for about 15% of all primary amenorrheas. Usually there will be a positive family history, and usually all these patients may be short and with the delayed bone age. And the diagnosis is mainly by exclusion and follow-up, and the prognosis is usually good. Actually, there is no need for drugs and only reassurance is needed. And consider the Kallmann syndrome. This is the second most common cause of hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. Here, there is a congenital deficiency of gonadotropin releasing hormone, and it is associated with anosmia. Actually, both these neurons develop together in the olfactory placot, and due to an X-linked recessive mutation of CAL1 gene, there is defective migration of these neurons from the olfactory placot along the cribriform plate of ethmoid to the olfactory bulb, and hence there is defective action of both. Here, usually the patient will be of tall height, and in addition to anosmia, midline facial defects like cleft lip and cleft palate can be there, and occasional renal agenesis can also be there. Among the CNS tumors, the most common cause is craniopharyngioma. Here, it compresses the pituitary stalk and interferes with the secretion of gonadotropin-releasing hormones, and gonadotropins and other pituitary hormones can also be deficient. This I have enlightened already. And these are the rare genetic causes that can produce hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. Now, considering the hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, actually, this is the most common cause. It accounts for about 50% of all primary amenorrhea. The most common cause is gonadal dysgenesis. Here, there is abnormal development of the gonads, resulting in the streak or fibrotic gonads, and they won't produce estrogen and progesterone. Hence, since there is no negative feedback, there is high levels of FSH and LH. FSH level more than 20 international unit and LH level more than 40 international unit is diagnostic. And among the gonadal dysgenesis, the most common is those with abnormal karyotype, that is Turner syndrome. Also, it can be with normal karyotype, then it is called pure gonadal dysgenesis. It can be 46XX or 46XY. Few words about Turner syndrome. The incidence is about 1 in 2,500 girls. And actually, here there is premature loss of germ cells starting from the mid-intrauterine life and proceeding in early childhood and puberty. And by the time of puberty, most of the germ cells must have been depleted. And the most common karyotype is 46XO. Mosaic can also be there. It can be 46XX or 46XY. In 46XX, the height may be normal and there may be spontaneous development of secondary sexual characters and menstruation. But there is accelerated germ cell loss resulting in premature ovarian insufficiency, premature ovarian failure. These are the classical features of Turner syndrome. It includes lots of dysmorphic features. The height is usually short stature is there. There is low posterior hairline, nuchal fold, shield-shaped thorax, widely spaced nipple, poor breast development, skeletal deformities, rudimentary ovaries. Heart diseases can be there, congenital heart diseases, including coarctation of aorta or bicuspid aortic valve. Renal diseases like horseshoe kidney can be there, and renal agenesis may also be there. So the management of Turner syndrome usually include a multidisciplinary approach. All these things, there is high chance for diabetes, high chance for thyroid disorders, autoimmune diseases, So all this has to be taken into consideration while managing these patients. In addition to hormone replacement therapy, growth hormone replacement may be needed. In addition to sex hormone replacement, growth hormone replacement may also be needed. And karyotyping is important because if Y chromosome is present, then there is high risk for malignancy. Hence, gonadectomy has to be considered. And considering the pure gonadal dystenosis, here the patient will be of normal height. And the karyotype is also normal, but gonads are abnormal or non-functioning. If the karyotype is 46XX and if it is associated with sensory neuronal deafness, it is called Perrault syndrome. And Swyer syndrome, here the karyotyping is 46XY and here there is a mutation of SRY gene. And it's an interesting disease because here the karyotyping is XY, but since the gonads are not functioning, there is no Mullerian inhibiting factor and there is no sex steroid. So the external and internal genitalia grow to the normal female type. And these are the enzyme deficiencies that prevent the normal estrogen production and result in hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. And in all this thing, that is 17 alpha hydroxylase deficiency, aromatase deficiency, or congenital adrenal hyperplasia, in all this thing, clitoromegaly and virilization may be present. Galactosemia associated with ovarian failure, and also FSH and LH receptor mutation, and severe damage to ovaries before the onset of puberty, as in irradiation or chemotherapy with alkylating agents like cyclophosphamide. All this can cause primary amenorrhea. Considering the eugonadotropic causes of primary amenorrhea, here there is normal secondary sexual characters, but pelvic abnormality, there is pelvic anatomy abnormality, and this accounts for about 20% of all cases of primary amenorrhea. Here, classifying the causes can be at the level of outflow tract obstruction, which can be imperforate hymen, transverse vaginal septum, or absence of cervix and vagina. Or there can be absence of functioning uterus, as in Mullerian agenesis or androgen insensitivity syndrome, or there can be absence of functioning endometrium. This is a picture of imperforate hymen, and this is the transverse vaginal septum. In both, the symptoms are almost similar. There may be intermittent cyclical lower abdominal pain, may be associated with difficulty in micturition, and a palpable lower abdominal swelling may be there, can be hematocolpus or hematometra. And to differentiate both, there may be a bulging membrane at the introitus in case of imperforate hymen, which increases on coughing. And treatment is excision of the septum or incising the hymen and draining the hematocolpus. And considering the cases with absent uterus, it can be either Mullerian agenesis or it can be androgen insensitivity syndrome. In Mullerian agenesis, that is Meyer-Rokitansky-Kusterhauser syndrome, this accounts for about 15% of primary amenorrhea. Here, there is absence of uterus, but all other factors are of normal female. That is, there is normal breast development, normal sexual hair development, normal looking external genitalia, normal female range of testosterone levels, and karyotyping is also 46XX, and the ovaries are normal, producing oocytes normally. And 15 to 30% of cases, it may be associated with renal, skeletal, or middle ear abnormalities. And since there is no uterus, we can't offer them menstruation or childbearing, but we can give them a good vagina for the purpose of sexual intercourse. That's the only treatment we can offer. And in case of Mullerian agenesis, we can do IVF with embryo transfer using their own oocytes to a surrogate mother. And considering the androgen insensitivity syndrome, here the chromosomal pattern is XY, but there is lack of androgen receptors. So the androgen is not acting, hence there is no axillary or pubic hair. And also because of the absence of action of testosterone, the external genitalia develops to the normal female type. But since there is normal Mullerian inhibiting factor production by the testes, there is absence of uterus and upper vagina. And usually the vagina is very short, and the testes, gonads are actually testes or undifferentiated gonads. And the breast is normally developed because of the hepatic estrogen production. And the androgen level will be as of male type. And considering the absence of functioning uterus, it can be either congenital absence of the endometrium, or it can be acquired as in Asherman syndrome. And the most common cause is genital tuberculosis here. There can also be cervical stenosis. So in brief, To enumerate the cause of primary amenorrhea, the most common cause is gonadal dyssynesis, which account for about 50%. Hypothalamic comes around 20%. Mullerian agenesis around 15%. Transverse vaginal septum and imperforate hymen account for about 5%. Pituitary disease is around 5%, and other 5% include congenital and androgen insensitivity syndrome, congenital adrenal hyperplasia or PCOS. So we have to arrive at a diagnosis. For this, history, physical examination and investigations are important. And in history, don't forget to ask about the pubertal development, premenstrual symptoms, and presence of any cyclical abdominal pain. And also ask medical history is important. Considering the chronic illness, any chronic illnesses for neoplasia, history of neoplasia, history of medications like alkylating agents, exposure to radiation, all this is important. Family history is also important because primary amenorrhea, the causes like constitutional delay or androgen insensitivity syndrome or Kallmann syndrome, this can run in families. Also, history of excessive exercise, weight loss, illicit drug use, all this is important. Also ask about anosmia, galactorrhea, headache, visual disturbances, hirsutism, acne, symptoms of thyroid disease, vasomotor symptoms, all this has to be asked. And in physical examination, growth chart is important and BMI measurement is also important. If by the age of 16 years, height is less than 147 centimeter, then there may be a possibility of Turner syndrome or panhypopituitarism. Secondary sexual characters has to be examined and TANA staging is to be done regarding the breast development and pubic hair development. Also look for any dysmorphic features and look for hirsutism, acne, thyroid should be examined, and abdomen examination, look for any palpable mass, that is hematocolpus. And in local examination, any bulge, local bulge is there, suggesting imperforate hymen, look for virilization, clitoromegaly. And in pelvic examination is important, and whether transverse vaginal septum is present, uterus is present or rudimentary, and per rectal examination also, here also we can evaluate the presence of uterus and also can look for any hematoswelling like hematocolpus. And among the investigation, ultrasound is most important. Here we can evaluate the ovaries, uterus, uterine size, and also hematocolpus can be diagnosed. And also in case of Turner's, we can look for horseshoe kidney or renal agenesis. And MRI may be needed to evaluate and pinpoint the diagnosis of hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, and rarely laparoscopy may be needed. And among the hormonal investigations, the most important one is FSH. Also LH, estradiol, testosterone, thyroid hormone, prolactin, all these are important. And serum DHEAS level helps to distinguish constitutional delay from congenital gonadotropin releasing hormone deficiency. Because in DHEAS is an androgen, adrenal androgen, which is independent of gonadotropin stimulation. And echo is also important in Turner syndrome, karyotyping is important. And finally, after all this examination, we have to arrive at a diagnosis. So here, first history and physical examination completed, and then look for the presence of secondary sexual characters. And if the secondary sexual characters are absent, then look for the FSH and LH levels. And if FSH level and LH level are less than 5 international units per liter, then the diagnosis is hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. So further investigate to exactly diagnose the hypothalamic or pituitary cause. And if the FSH and LH levels are more than 20 international units and LH more than 40 international units, then the diagnosis is hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. So the problem is at the level of gonads. So do the karyotyping. So Turner's can be diagnosed, or karyotype of XY karyotype may be there, Turner mosaic may be there, and other causes of gonadal failure can also be diagnosed. And if the secondary sexual characters are normal, then perform an ultrasound to see the whether uterus is present or absent. If the uterus is absent or abnormal, then there are two possibilities, androgen insensitivity syndrome or Mullerian agenesis. Then do the karyotype. If it is 46XY, the diagnosis is androgen insensitivity syndrome. And if the karyotype is 46XX, the diagnosis is Mullerian agenesis. And if uterus is normally present, then look for any outflow tract obstruction. And if there is no outflow tract obstruction, then evaluate for the causes of secondary amenorrhea. that is hypothyroidism, hyperprolactinemia, PCOS, Cushing syndrome, etc. And if outflow tract is obstructed, then differentiate between imperforate hymen and transverse vaginal septum. And few words regarding the treatment of primary amenorrhea. Specific causes, whenever detected, should be corrected. And in case of constitutional delay, actually there is no need for hormone replacement therapy. Vitamin A and iron supplementation may be of help. Sex hormone therapy should be limited to girls over 12 years of age having no or few secondary sexual characteristics. While taking hormone replacement therapy, bone age should be monitored 6 monthly during the treatment. And considering the hormone replacement therapy, the goal is to initiate, mature and maintain the secondary sexual characters and menstruation and to prevent osteoporosis. Cyclical estrogen and progesterone therapy is used. And here, estrogen is the most preferred. First, we have to start the treatment with estrogen, prime the patient with low-dose estrogen, gradually increase in dose, and establishing the normal secondary sexual characters, and then only the progesterone is started. The estrogen, the most preferred form is micronized 17-beta estradiol. It can be given orally or transdermally, and transdermal route is more preferred. Conjugated equine estrogen can also be used. Start with the low dose. That is 17-beta estradiol micronized can be started at a dose of 0.5 to 1 milligram per day orally or 25 microgram transdermally. And in case of conjugated estrogen, start with the dose of 0.3 milligram. If the patient is short, higher doses should be avoided in order to avoid the premature closure of epiphysis. And the dose has to be increased only after 6 months to 1 year. But if the height is normal, we can use higher doses of estrogen initially itself. 1 to 2 milligram of micronized 17-beta estradiol orally or 100 micrograms of 17-beta estradiol transdermally or 0.625 to 1.25 milligram conjugated equine estrogen orally. That is the maintenance dose. And estrogen therapy should be started initially and in order to prime the secondary attain the secondary sexual normal development, it takes 2 to 3 years. And progesterone therapy should be withheld till the completion of breast growth or till the onset of breakthrough bleeding. So progesterone has to be withheld for in the initial 12 to 24 months of estrogen therapy. And if the menstruation begins in between, you can start progesterone therapy. And progesterone, since we are treating primary amenorrhea, sequential progesterone is preferred. It can be either 10 milligram medroxyprogesterone acetate daily for 12 days every month or 200 milligrams of micronized progesterone daily for 12 days every month. Better to start the first 12 days of every month. And among this, actually, micronized progesterone is more preferred. After full dose of estradiol and medroxyprogesterone acetate is reached, we can shift it to combined oral contraceptive pills in order to avoid two medications. And also this is more expensive compared to combined OCPs. But the problem is estrogen is more potent here. So there is slightly more chance for venous thromboembolism with OCPs. And this hormone replacement therapy should be continued till the age of natural menopause. And in girls with Turner syndrome, they will be usually very short. And so before starting the sex hormone replacement therapy, we have to attain the normal height with growth hormone therapy. And growth hormone has to be started from the time when there is a dip from the normal, a dip in the normal linear growth. Usually it starts by the age of 8 years and it has to be continued till the age of 12 to 14 years. And this growth hormone is given as a bedtime injection every day. And oxandrolone is a non-aromatized anabolic steroid, anabolic androgen, and it can also be added to increase the growth. And the patients with hypogonadotropic hypogonadism are potentially fertile, and we can achieve pregnancy and ovulation and pregnancy, and the treatment of choice is gonadotropin therapy. Also in hypothalamic causes, pulsatile gonadotropin releasing hormone therapy can also be used. And also other supportive measures we can offer them is those with inadequate breast, we can offer them breast implants. And also in patients with absence of vagina, that is in case of MRK syndrome or complete androgen insensitivity syndrome or congenital adrenal hyperplasia. In all this thing, vagina will be very short. So we can offer them sexually to ensure a normal sexual intercourse, we can offer them good vagina either by using dilators, that is serial dilators can be used, and it can offer about 88% of success rate in about 19 months of use. And also we can offer them McIndoe's neo-vagina, that is vaginoplasty. Here a space is created between the bladder and urethra anteriorly and rectum posteriorly. Here a dissection is carried out up to the level of peritoneum, and then a mold is kept there, covering with either skin graft or with artificial skin like interstice, and it is kept there for 7 days after suturing the labia majora, and after 7 days it's removed and serial dilatation is carried out. And this procedure has to be done either soon before marriage or just after marriage. So I think I have covered many of the problems of primary amenorrhea and the management. So thank you for patient hearing. Thank you so much.
You can just stop sharing. Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Sajana. That was a very wonderful presentation, which has covered elaborately all the aspects of evaluation and management. I would like to add one thing. When the karyotyping is XY, it is not only the androgen insensitivity syndrome, 5-alpha reductase deficiency, which is seen more clinically, clinical cases of primary amenorrhea with XY karyotyping. So that is more common when we see patients of primary amenorrhea, 5-alpha reductase, because they present with ambiguous genitalia, especially the newborns. So that is one highlight. And I would just like to ask you something, because a few people are watching the program in the virtual platform. So the questions are coming as comments. So in this, what is the, how can we interpret the testosterone level in a case of primary amenorrhea? Because general investigations like FSH, LH, prolactin, TSH, all those things are very commonly done, because the primary amenorrhea panel, when we write, all these things will be included. But generally, rarely, the testosterone will not get much attention. So how can we interpret a laboratory report of testosterone in a case of primary amenorrhea? Actually, that question has been put forward by one postgraduate student from Trivandrum Medical College. Okay.
I'm not very sure, sir. It's increased in androgen insensitivity syndrome and 5-alpha reductase inhibit this thing also. So I think you can answer better than me than that.
I think to that person who has asked question, I think we can put it in a very simple way. The testosterone investigation is relevant when the uterus is absent on ultrasound. So testosterone will be in the female range in MRKH syndrome. In all other cases, it will be in the male range. That's what I would like to convey. That is more easier to understand, because in the male range of testosterone will be seen in XY, and XX it is in the female range. I think that's the only relevance with regard to the testosterone.
Another thing is, if in case of polycystic ovarian syndrome also, they sometimes can present with primary amenorrhea. So it could be another thing that can elevate the testosterone levels, right?
DHEAs also will be elevated. When Ramya is sitting there, is there any malignancy cause which can cause primary amenorrhea? No, just of curiosity I'm asking, because when I saw you, I thought I'd ask this question. Any malignancies?
Like androgen secreting tumors.
Yeah, it can cause, no? Because androgen, few of the ovarian tumors, which secretes abnormal amount of androgens, isn't it? Am I right?
Of course.
No, because nowadays the incidence of malignancy is going up, especially in the adolescent age group. So they may even present with that. But this androgen insensitivity and this ambiguous genitalia, nowadays
gonadoblastoma also, there's a gonadoblastoma can occur in ill-developed gonads. So if there is a gonad present, then it has to be removed in such cases before they reach puberty, especially in XY karyotype.
Any tumors extragenital means not in the reproductive tract, anything which can create testosterone, no? Adrenal tumors, isn't it? Then this thing, what is the relevance of MRI? MRI, see, it is very commonly done because we landed up in trouble with one patient. We just she presented with primary amenorrhea, but with severe pain. But whenever we do the ultrasound, we were not able to locate any of the lesions. But when the MRI was done and the laparoscopy was done once, we couldn't find anything. The patient was sent home, didn't have any relief. Then ultimately, some investigation has to be done when they come repeatedly. That's why we did an MRI. Then found a small rudimentary horn, which is that rudimentary horn is actually connecting to the vaginal septum, and the other part of the uterus was non-cavitated like. So ultimately the reproductive outcome will be very bad. We had to excise the vaginal septum, we had to excise the rudimentary horn, reconstruct the uterus. Still the patient is having primary amenorrhea, but she is symptomatically free. Because this pain during this imperforate hymen or vagin, transverse vaginal septum or rudimentary horn, that will be very excruciating pain. So at least we could relieve that. So MRI also has some role, especially in all our settings where we all practice, because before putting the endoscope in. Am I right? Then no more questions, anybody else wants to add anything? All the audience, the session is open for discussion. Okay, if there are no more questions, we'll move on to the next session. That is the session on HPV vaccines. That is again another session which we need a real brainstorming, because in spite of all the awareness programs, the HPV vaccination program is in a very bad shape, because nobody wants to take vaccine. No doctors wants to take vaccination for their children, their daughters. See, the doctors, they themselves do not encourage vaccines. That's what the scenario which I happen to see very often. So in this background, we will have a very wonderful presentation from Dr. Ramya, who is the consultant gynae oncologist at Aster MIMS Hospital. And not only that, Dr. Ramya is a very active member of POADS. She'll be there for all the activities in the forefront and contributing in many ways, whether it is cultural, whether it is dance, whether it is any Onam celebrations, any public awareness programs, she'll be there. So welcome Dr. Ramya to have the presentation on HPV vaccination.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for that introduction. So good evening, everyone. Today I'll be talking on HPV vaccination. Of course, I'm very happy to talk on this subject because this is often a matter of public interest, because this HPV vaccine has been subjected to a lot of controversies as well as misinterpretations from the part of media regarding the safety of this vaccine since its early introductory trials in India. Despite the fact that this vaccine has been introduced in the national immunization schedule of majority of the developed countries in the world, and nearly 270 million doses of vaccine has been distributed all over the world, and with the proven efficacy of the vaccine and with no concerns on the safety, it is quite unfortunate that in India we don't have a well-structured screening program for CA cervix, as well as we don't have a proper HPV vaccination program. So I think this vaccine, at the end of the presentation, you will just think of, you think of vaccinating your own children with at least one dose of HPV vaccine. That is what I aim with this presentation. So we'll start with the presentation. So as you all know, cancer has become an important cause of mortality as well as decreasing life expectancy all over the world. Cervical cancer is the fourth most frequently diagnosed cancer. It is the fourth leading cause of cancer death in women. Nearly 6 lakh new cases and 3,42,000 deaths have been reported worldwide as of the Globocon data 2020. But we see a decrease in the incidence and mortality rates regarding cervical cancer from most areas of the world for the past few decades. And this trend may be because of an improvement in the socioeconomic status, maybe because of reduced parity, reduced prevalence of STD due to increased health awareness, as well as early diagnosis and treatment of sexually transmitted disorders, as well as the well-organized screening programs that has been conducted in various countries of the world. Despite this fact, you can see on the right side, I have put a slide. You can see some countries of Africa, they are having still having very high incidence of cervical cancer, and actually they are showing a rise in trend of cervical cancer. And so there is a gross inequity in the distribution of cervical cancer throughout the world. So from this figure, you can see that next to Africa stands Southeast Asia, including India. So it is a major cause of mortality and morbidity over the world. So taking the Indian scenario, you see that 1,23,000 new cervical cancer cases and nearly 77,000 deaths have been reported from India, and it ranks second among the women cancers. That is 18.3% of the total women cancers is contributed by CS cervix alone, and this is according to the Globocon 2020 data. But in India, we also see that the cancer incidence is declining at a rate of 1 to 2% per year. And the incidence of cervical cancer in India is 14.7 per lakh. And in Kerala, it is nearly half of what we have in India. It is only 7 per lakh. But cervical cancer is a totally preventable disease, because we do have very good screening methods, and we do have a very good vaccine available. So in spite of all these measures available, in India, we have not implemented all these measures properly. And the disease still persists as a great burden, especially in the people of low socioeconomic status. And so it's a very important issue of gross inequity. So he is Sir Harald Zerhausen. He has won the Nobel Prize in 2008 for his pioneering work on HPV. He postulated that oncogenic human papillomavirus is causing cervical cancer. So his discovery has led to the characterization of the natural history of HPV infection and understanding of the HPV-induced carcinogenesis, as well as the development of HPV vaccines. So hats off to him. So you can see the epidemiological relationships of HPV. HPV is responsible for all these types of cancers that has been represented in this figure. It is responsible for more than 90% of cervical cancers, more than 90% of anal cancers, more than 70% of vaginal and vulvar cancers, more than 60% of penile cancers, and more than 70% of oropharyngeal cancers. So all these are attributed to a single virus, that is human papillomavirus. So to refresh your memory, on the right side I have put is the what I have put is the structure of the HPV human papillomavirus. So it's a double-stranded non-enveloped DNA virus. You may remember the early genes and the late genes of this virus. The early genes E6, E7, E and E5 are the oncogenes, which is responsible for HPV-induced carcinogenesis. And you should also be familiar with the late genes, of which L1, which codes for the major capsid protein of the virus. And this protein is is used for manufacturing HPV vaccines. And regarding the transmission of HPV, HPV exposure can occur with any type of intimate sexual contact. Any type of contact with the infected skin or the fluids can transmit HPV infection, and it is not necessary that you should have intercourse. And the condoms actually do not completely stop the transmission of HPV. That is why the incidence of HPV infection in the population is very high. So it may be as high as 24% in less than 25 years. And the maximum infection or the maximum incidence of HPV infection is between 15 to 30 year age group. That is the early in the early sexual life. But majority of the infections, 70 to 90% will be asymptomatic, and they usually resolve spontaneously within 1 to 2 years. And in India, the prevalence of chronic HPV infection will be as high as 10 to 20%. It is a DNA virus. More than 200 documented genotypes are there, of which 40 are known to infect the anogenital tract, and 12 to 14 are classified as high-risk genotypes, of which 16 and 18 are responsible for 85% of cervical cancers in India. So it's a slow growing disease. You acquire the infection in your early sexual life, that is 15 to 30 years, but it turns to malignancy after a lead time of nearly 10 to 15 years, or supposedly usually the cervical cancer is diagnosed in the middle age group. Even though it is having a bimodal distribution pattern, the most common age group in which you can see cervical cancer is between 45 to 55 years. So it's a slow growing disease. So this type of progression, it will provide opportunities for prevention, early detection and treatment. So cervical cancer can be altogether eliminated. So this slide is actually adopted from WHO. WHO has mentioned three key interventions in scale to be implemented in the countries as a life course approach to cervical cancer prevention and control. That includes the primary prevention, which is vaccinating the girls between 9 to 14 years of age with HPV vaccine, and educating girls and boys, the sexual education, condom promotion, male circumcision, all are included in primary prevention. The secondary prevention is aimed at screen and more than 30 years of age, that is early detection of precancerous lesion. So you can utilize the screen and treat approach, that is a single visit approach, and you can do rapid HPV testing. So you should follow the screening protocols. And the tertiary prevention is aimed at early detection and proper treatment of cervical cancer. So WHO has called for elimination of cervical cancer. It envisions a world without cervical cancer. So the goal that is set, that is to keep the incidence as a measure of the goal which has been put laid down is to keep the incidence of cervical cancer to less than 4 cases per 1 lakh woman years. That means if you are remembering the previous slide, we can see that the incidence of cervical cancer in India is 14.7 per 1 lakh. So we have a long way to go. And to achieve this goal, they have put down three targets, that is to be achieved by 2030. That is 90% of girls fully vaccinated with HPV vaccine by 15 years of age, 70% of women screened with an HPV test at least at 35 and 45 years of age, and 90% should be managed appropriately, and 30% reduction in the mortality from cervical cancer. So if you are able to achieve these targets, you will be able to avoid 74 million cases and more than 60 million deaths over the course of the next century. But this goal is projected to be achieved by 2055 to 59 in high developed nations, and it may take until the end of 21st century in the developing and the developed and the underdeveloped countries. So with this introduction, I will come to the topic, that is the HPV vaccines. So how this vaccine is manufactured? The vaccine is manufactured using the recombinant DNA technology, and it utilizes the L1 gene of the HPV DNA that is introduced into the plasmid, and you will get the capsid proteins, the L1 capsid protein, so that makes an empty shell. So this is actually a novel vaccine strategy, because the viral genetic material is not included, and it is the production is by some non-mammalian processing systems. So it is safe in that aspect. And this L1 protein is having very high immunogenic response. It is found that the immunity or the antibody response consequent to a vaccine, consequent to vaccination, is 1 to 4 logs higher than that acquired during a natural infection. So it is highly immunogenic and it is relatively safe. So these are the first generation vaccines which are available. The quadrivalent vaccine, or the HPV4, which was approved by FDA since 2006, and it contains all these four genotypes. L1, it uses virus-like particles, recombinant L1 capsid proteins of these individual types. These are the most common HPV types that are infecting, and the 6 and 11, which cause benign warts, and 16 and 18, which are the causative factors for majority of the cervical cancers. So in females, it gives protection against anal, cervical, vaginal, and vulvar precancers, and cancer and the genital warts. And in males, it provides protection against anal precancer and genital warts. The only contraindication for vaccine will be pregnancy, and if you are hypersensitive to yeast, and also hypersensitivity to the vaccine components, which will be the aluminum hydroxide sulfate or aluminum hydroxyphosphate, which is used, and it is usually administered as a 3-dose series at an interval of 0, 2 and 6 months. 0.5 ml of vaccine is given intramuscularly. Similarly, we have the bivalent vaccine, which is another first generation vaccine. It is active against these two HPV types, 16 and 18, which are the most common post
for cancerous stages in the cervix. So it protects against the cervical precancer and cancer, but it is not approved for use in males because it doesn't provide protection against genital warts. It is not, because the genotype 6 and 11, it is not providing protection. So it is not recommended in males. And of course, the contraindication will be pregnancy and hypersensitivity to latex or hypersensitivity to the vaccine adjuvant that is used. And it is given in a 3-dose series of 0, 1, and 6 months. The second generation vaccine is the nonavalent vaccine. Nonavalent vaccine protects against 5 additional types of HPV compared to Gardasil 4. And this is approved by US FDA in 2014. And all these types of, against all these type of HPV, it provides protection. From the studies, it is found that Gardasil 9 is as effective as Gardasil for the prevention of diseases caused by the 4 major types of HPV, that is 6, 11, 16, and 18, based on similar antibody response in the participants in the clinical studies. And the trials that lead to the approval of Gardasil 9 has found that it is 100% effective against the 5 additional types of HPV it is having compared to Gardasil 4. But it's licensed in India, but it's not available in India. So you can see the countries which have included this HPV vaccination in their national immunization schedule. You can see India is nowhere in the scene. And nearly 30% of girls between 9 to 14 years are getting vaccinated globally. So everyone will be concerned of the efficacy of the vaccine. How efficient is the vaccine in preventing the HPV-induced carcinogenesis? So this slide depicts the major trials which have brought out the efficacy of the HPV vaccine in preventing the effectively the precancerous lesions caused by HPV. So regarding Gardasil, we do have 3 major randomized, well-designed randomized controlled trials. Of these, the most important trial is the Future 1-2 trials. And this trial has proved that Gardasil is having 98% efficacy in preventing the cervical precancers. It is 100% efficacious in preventing vulvar or vaginal precancers and genital warts. And this is the famous Patricia trial based on cervarix. And it also has proved that it is having more than 90% efficacy in preventing the cervical precancerous lesions as well as adenocarcinoma in situ. So these studies were conducted in a large group of women, that is 16,000 to 18,000 women. So the efficacy of these 2 vaccines have been proved beyond doubt, and they are very effective in preventing the precancerous lesions. In addition, the Gardasil and Cervarix will help in providing cross protection. What is meant by cross protection is that they are acting against some other HPV viruses, viral genotypes, which are not present in the vaccine. So that is more prominent with Cervarix, and it offers cross protection against 31, 45, and 52 genotypes of HPV. So these are the key findings from the clinical trials. You can see that the infection efficacy is proven, CIN 2 plus, 3 plus, vaginal and vulvar intraepithelial and neoplasia, the genital warts efficacy, all these have been proven. And there was no safety concerns. And these the studies have been proven in the young woman, the mid-adult woman, as well as in the young men. And this is the WHO position paper, which was published in 2017 regarding the efficacy of the HPV vaccines. So what they have found is that for the quadrivalent vaccine, the 3-dose schedule, there was no breakthrough cases of the cervical or genital related disease related to these HPV types when they are having a 10 years of follow-up period. And for the bivalent vaccine, they do have a follow-up of 8.4 and 9.4 years, where they have found that the immunogenicity and efficacy, it has been demonstrated against infection and cervical lesions associated with HPV 16 and 18. For the nonavalent vaccines, because it was introduced in 2014 only, we have a follow-up of only 5.6 years, but the vaccine has proved to be effective. And the antibody levels reached following a 2-dose schedule, that is 0 and 6 months, 2-dose schedule of the bivalent and quadrivalent vaccine in girls 9 to 14 years, it remains comparable to that of 3-dose schedule. So that is why less than 15 years of age, you recommend, or there is need to administer only 2 doses of the vaccine. But it is not yet known whether you need the booster doses, because it will require several years of follow-up again, because we do have follow-up of maximum of some 15 years, because the vaccine is introduced for use from 2006 onwards only. And based upon the data, up to 9.4 years after the primary 3-dose immunization series, there is no waning of immunity over time. So up to 9.4 years, the immunity has not waned over time. And so far we have very good randomized controlled trials which were able to prove that HPV has reduced the incidence of precancerous lesions of the cervix, but we don't know whether it actually prevents the cervical cancer. That is because it is not easy for the randomized controlled trials to prove that, because the cervical cancer is having a very long lead time, and along with that, if you administer the vaccine, the incidence of precancerous lesions will be reduced, and so you will not be able to correlate the actual effect of HPV vaccination reducing the risk of invasive cervical cancer. So this is actually a population based registry based cohort study which was done in Sweden, and that was published in 2020. They have actually followed up nearly 1 million girls between 10 to 31 years of age, and they were having age matched controls of unvaccinated women also. What they have found is that they have diagnosed cervical cancer in 19 women who received quadrivalent vaccine and in 538 women who have not received the vaccine. So the cumulative incidence of cervical cancer cases was 47 per 1 lakh in women who have been vaccinated compared to 94 per 1 lakh in women who have not been vaccinated. That means double the rate in the unvaccinated group. They have also found that if you are vaccinating children below 17 years of age, the efficacy is much better. What is written here is those who have been vaccinated before the age of 17 years, the cumulative incidence of cancer was just 4 cases per 1 lakh in the at the age of 28 years. And also the risk of cervical cancer among participants who had initiated vaccination before the age of 17 years was 88% lower than among those who had never been vaccinated. So this evidence supports that HPV vaccination actually reduces the risk of invasive carcinoma of the cervix. So Australia is one of the first countries to introduce the vaccine in their national immunization schedule, because the vaccine is actually born in Australia only. So they introduced this vaccine in 2007. In 2013, they have started vaccinating the boys also. And so regarding the first generation vaccine, they have found that it is found to protect against about 70% of cervical cancers, 75% of anal cancer cases, and 70% of vaginal, as well as 40 to 50% of vulvar and penile cancer cases. And the second generation vaccine is found to be even more efficacious than Gardasil 4 in protecting against these cancers. And Gardasil and Gardasil 9 additionally protects against 90% of the genital warts. So in the first 4 to 5 years after their program they have started, they have noted a decrease in the HPV infection rate, nearly 77% in 18 to 24 year old group. And the precancerous abnormalities in Australia also reduced by 34% in the 20 to 24 year old. So, and the nonavalent vaccine has found to prevent persistent infection and the precancerous lesions associated with all the 9 types of genotypes that is present in the vaccine. So the efficacy of the vaccine has been proved beyond doubt. So the next matter of concern regarding the HPV vaccine is the safety of the vaccine. How much safe is the vaccine? Because since the introductory trials in India, the trials which were conducted in India in the initial phases, that was stopped initially itself. That is because of some side effects that have been reported in the vaccines. So that was actually a false interpretation, especially from the media side. So this is the Global Advisory Committee on Vaccine Safety regarding the safety of the HPV vaccines, which was published in 2015. So the GACVS has found that to date, it has found that there is no safety issue regarding the vaccine that would alter its recommendations for use. The only side effects associated with this vaccine was minor side effects, that is pain and redness at the injection site, fever, headache, tiredness, nausea, muscle or joint pain. No major side effects have been reported. The only major side effect that has been reported was syncopal attack, but there was no recurring of the cases, but it was non-recurring and there was no clustering of the cases. So they have recommended that because of this particular problem, if you vaccinate a lady, you ask her to sit for some time so that you can avoid injuries from falling. So that was the only major adverse event that has been reported with this vaccine. The CDC and the US FDA has been constantly monitoring the safety of this vaccine, and these are the three systems that are constantly monitoring the events regarding the vaccine safety. All the adverse events will be reported to these systems, and CDC is constantly monitoring the whatever adverse event has been reported. So far the vaccine is found to be safe. Again, this is the experience from Australia following 11 years of experience. So these are the adverse events of special interest that they have mentioned here. This is after 10 million doses of vaccine that has been distributed. We can see that the only major adverse event is syncope, and that is only 856 cases, and that is not considered significant. And rest of all these problems, that they are actually consistent with, they are actually similar to the background rates only. So other adverse events of special interest were reported very rarely, and they are consistent with other studies. So the vaccine is relatively safe for administration. So what is the recommendation for giving with this vaccine? So I will start with the CDC recommendation. CDC and the ACIP Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices recommendation. So you start vaccinating all girls from 11 to 12 years. You can start from the age of 9 years itself. You can give all these three doses, three types of vaccine, that is nonavalent, quadrivalent, or bivalent vaccine can be used. And you can and catch up vaccination up to the age of 26 years. And it is given as a series of either two doses or three doses. That depends upon the age of initiation of vaccination. But they are not recommending this vaccine beyond 26 years. But you can suggest the vaccine in this age group, that is from 27 to 45 years. You have to discuss with the patient. You tell them that there is reduced efficacy because it is not going to protect against the HPV genotypes that has already been infected. But it may provide some protection against those genotypes which they have not been come in contact with. So you can discuss with the patient, and you may also give this vaccine from 27 to 45 years. And the second dose of vaccine, the two-dose schedule, the second dose of vaccine should be given 6 to 12 months after the first dose. As you all know, the memory cells will take around 4 to 6 months to register that memory. And so that is why they recommend the second dose to be given 6 to 12 months, or it can be extended up to 18 months maximum. And adolescents who receive two doses less than 5, if you're receiving the second dose less than 5 months, then you need to take one more dose. So you have to follow the third dose. You have to take the third dose also. And the recommended three-dose schedule will be 0, 1 to 2, and 6 months. So, and for immunocompromised people, including those with HIV, you need to give three doses regardless of their age from 9 to 26 years. Of course, the vaccine is contraindicated in those with a history of previous allergic reaction, either to the vaccine, either to yeast or to latex or to the vaccine adjuvants. This is the absolute contraindication for this vaccine. Of course, the vaccine is not recommended for use in pregnancy. The studies are not supporting. There is no concrete evidence. But some trials have shown that those who have been inadvertently vaccinated during pregnancy, they have not reported any fetal effects, or they have not reported any spontaneous abortions or miscarriages. So even if it is given during vaccination, there is no need for termination of pregnancy. And if they have started the vaccination series, they should delay the initiation of vaccination series until after pregnancy. But pregnancy testing before vaccination is not required. And the nonavalent or the quadrivalent vaccine has been licensed for use in males 11 to 12 years up to the age of 21 years, and it is given as three dose series. Less than 15 years males also, you need to give only two doses, and more than 15 years, three doses. And ACIP recommends vaccinating homosexual men with either nonavalent or quadrivalent vaccine up to the age of 26 years. And even if you have given the full course of vaccination, you will have to pursue your screening protocols according to your country. And because there are so many types of HPV, and 12 to 14 are high risk types, and we don't know. So the vaccine is giving protection maximum up to 9 genotypes of HPV. So that is why you will have to continue your screening according to your national protocols. And IAP, Indian Academy of Pediatrics, is also supporting HPV vaccination. The only difference I have quoted in red lines, that is the HPV, only HPV 4 and HPV 2 are licensed and available in India. HPV 9 is not available, though it is licensed. And it is HPV 4 or Gardasil is not yet licensed for use in males in India. The problem in India is mainly the cost factor. So IAP is not recommending or stressing on the vaccination of males. This is because if you are vaccinating the females with very good coverage, that is, if you are having more than 50% coverage of in female vaccination itself, that spontaneously it will generate a herd immunity that will generate a herd immunity. So from the trials they have found that in heterosexual men, the immunity against HPV has been enhanced. So that is why they are not supporting vaccination for males in India.
And what is the stand of Foxy regarding the HPV vaccination? This is they are recommending the same thing. You give two doses. The target age group should be 9 to 14 years, and you give two doses. And 15 years and onwards, up to 26 years, or maximum up to 45 years, you have to give three doses. And the interval should be 0 to 6 months for two dose regime, and 0-1-6 for bivalent, and 0-2-6 for quadrivalent. And catch up vaccination up to 26 years. And for older age group, actually, Foxy doesn't recommend it is not stressing on vaccination in this particular age group because of reduced efficacy of vaccine in this particular age group. And better you concentrate on improving the screening or improving the coverage of screening in this age group rather than concentrating on vaccinating this age group. That is the stand of Foxy. And in special situations, in HIV positive or immunocompromised, you have to give three dose schedule. You have to give vaccine as three doses. And if you have interrupted dose, you need not restart the vaccination. You continue whatever vaccine dose is left for you. You have to continue. And one thing is, if you are giving the first dose of vaccine before 15 years, and by default she has not taken the second dose of vaccine, so if she has become more than 15 years, so she needs to take a single more dose of vaccine. That is, two doses only is required if you have initiated the vaccination before 15 years. And pregnancy, of course, vaccination is contraindicated. In lactation, you can continue vaccination. And the victims of sexual abuse, you need to give three doses, and the first dose should be given immediately at the time of examination itself. And women with a history of previous abnormal screening reports, the three dose schedule can be followed. And this is the group of women, most commonly the 26 to 45 year age group. You have to tell them that the efficacy will be reduced. But some trials have shown that those women who have been treated for some precancerous lesions of cervix, and they have the vaccine has been administered, in such patients, the chance of recurrence of the precancerous lesions has found to be decreased. So the vaccine is having some efficacy at that point. So why you want to vaccinate in the early teenage itself? What is the reason? That is because highest antibody response occurs when you administer the vaccine between 9 to 14 years. It is important that you have to start the vaccination before the onset of sexual activity. And along with that, you can get this vaccine co-administered with other vaccines like meningococcal, because so it can be considered as just another adolescent vaccine. So that will reduce the morality issues. As you all know, this vaccine is meant for preventing a sexually transmitted disease. So of course, the morality issues will be less. So if it is considered as just, if you counsel like it is just another adolescent vaccine and you are administering in that age group, it will be very easy to give. And these are the top five reasons why parents resent vaccination. Either because my child is not sexually active, why you want to give the vaccine for a sexually transmitted disease, or maybe because of the lack of knowledge, or maybe because of the safety concerns regarding the safety of the vaccine. And the fourth one is, it is not recommended by the provider. So I have encircled it because that is one major problem that we are facing, because even the clinicians are not aware of the safety or efficacy of this vaccine as of now. So it should be taken as a collective responsibility of the pediatrician as well as the obstetrician to promote this vaccine, to get it taken by the target age group, especially in India, in a country where there is a high burden of disease. And also they may consider it as not needed or necessary. So these are the prime reasons why parents resent vaccination. So this is the current status of human papillomavirus vaccination in India. What all has happened since the licensure of the vaccine in India? I have just put it in a flow chart. So in 2008, this vaccine has been, bivalent and quadrivalent vaccines has been licensed in India. And in 2009, by September, we started demonstration projects in Andhra Pradesh and Gujarat. These demonstration projects were actually meant to find out the operational feasibility of this vaccine and not to assess the safety or efficacy, only to find out the operational feasibility, whether it can be introduced into the national immunization program. And they were supposed to target around, the target population was 10 to 18 years age females. Between 10 to 18 years of age, and they were planning to recruit nearly 20,000 children. So, and this the study was it was planned as a well-structured randomized control study. It was conducted by the IARC, International Agency for Research of Cancer, for cancer, and it was funded by a US NGO. So, what happened after 1 year is, by April 2010. A few deaths were reported in the vaccinees. About 7 deaths were reported from the vaccinees. So that was the first setback for HPV vaccination in India. So these deaths were falsely reported by the media as due to vaccination. Without any further inquiry, government of India actually banned the vaccine from all the trials, even though it continues to be available for prescription. So that study got temporarily stopped. Actually, that study, they also have meant to compare 2 doses versus 3 doses of the vaccine. But what happened is they got temporarily stuck up at that point. So so at that point of time, they had four cohorts of people. That is one who has received 1 dose by default, one group who has received 2 doses by default, and the third group which had taken 0 and 6 months 2 doses, and the fourth group which have taken all the 3 doses. So 4 cohorts of people. So these cohorts of people they have made it an observational cohort study, and they are still following up this group of patients to assess the vaccine efficacy and safety. So after that, in 2016, Delhi state government initiated HPV vaccination. That was an opportunistic vaccination, and that is still carried on with very good coverage. And by the time, similar efficacy of 2 and 3 doses of HPV vaccination was established in this previous study, because they have been following this cohort of people over this much time. So the 2016, the results, first preliminary results of the study was out. And in 2017, Punjab initiates HPV vaccination in the Bathinda and Mansar districts. Now they are continuing it, and they actually they are vaccinating the school students of the 6th standard, and they are having very good coverage also. And in 2018, similar efficacy of 1 versus 2 or 3 doses in preventing persistent HPV 16-18 infections were reported from the same study. And Sikkim also started vaccinating all the school girls. So in Delhi, Sikkim and Punjab is still continuing this vaccination with good coverage, with no documented safety problems, and with good efficacy. In 2019, updated evidence from the IARC study indicates that 2 doses of vaccine could be extended to girls aged 15 to 18. So these are the things which happened in India. So far, the vaccine is introduced. Unfortunately, this vaccine has not been included in our national immunization schedule, even though it is available in the private sector. But the cost of the vaccine is most important prohibiting factor. And another thing is the lack of political commitment. A good thing about the vaccine is that the Serum Institute of India has started manufacturing a quadrivalent HPV vaccine, and that is currently undergoing phase 2, phase 3 trials for efficacy and safety. And another Chinese vaccine is yet to come available. So by the time these 2 vaccines are available, we can think that the cost will be considerably reduced, and so that it will become available to the most needy population. So dose recommendation for HPV vaccine can be extended up to 18 years. This is the updated evidence from the Indian follow-up cohort study. So what they are telling, that the 2 doses, you can extend the 2-dose regimen up to 18 years of age. So in short term, this this will be implemented, at least in India. And the efficacy of single dose of vaccine compared to a standard 2 or 3 doses. This was a systematic review from evidence of so many clinical trials. So many clinical trials are ongoing on this aspect. The idea behind this trial is to reduce the number of doses so that you can reduce the cost of vaccination, so that you can include this vaccine in the national immunization schedule of majority of the underdeveloped nations, where there is the most needy population. And here, this study has found that 1 HPV dose may be as effective in preventing HPV infection as multi-dose schedules in healthy young women, but it also highlights the paucity of available evidence. So you need well-designed, prospective, randomized controlled trials to come true. So you can see the antibody levels following 1 dose, 2 dose, and 3 dose vaccination. So the antibody levels following the 2 and 3 doses will be comparatively similar. You can see that for the single dose, the antibody peak is not that high, but it is maintaining a sustained level of immune response when you reach here. So in the long term, once the study of these clinical trials, these randomized trials are out, you may be able to, you may be required to give only a single dose of HPV vaccine. So to conclude, a judicious combination of efficient cervical cancer screening programs and efficient HPV vaccination program, it will be highly conducive for the elimination of cervical cancer in India. The declining incidence of cervical cancer cancer should not be a setback for vaccination, because this is actually an argument against the introduction of HPV vaccine. Already the cancer rate is declining in India, so why you want to introduce this HPV vaccination, which is very costly, rather than boosting your screening protocols? So the problem is already there is the trend is showing a decline. So if you combine with vaccination, of course you will be, it will be an opportunity to eliminate the disease altogether. Another problem is that even if the disease is showing a declining trend at this point of time, you may not be sure that it will not rise in the future, because of the changing socio-cultural norms and the changing sexual behavior. There can be, you can also expect a rise in the incidence of cervical cancer over the years. So that is what happened in China. We do have evidence from China also. In China in 2000, they were actually, the population was showing a decline in trend of cervical cancer, but later they had a rise in the incidence of disease, especially among the young individuals. And that was because of the changes in the sexual behavior. So that can occur in India also. So that is why you have to combine vaccination along with screening to completely eliminate the disease. And so no major adverse events or deaths have been reported so far. So it is not only cost effective. You can think of the millions that has been spent on treatment of the carcinoma cervix, and what is the morbidity, what is the mortality from CS cervix, and what is the quality of life in a person who has been affected with CS cervix. So considering all those things, HPV vaccination is not only cost effective but also fiscally sustainable for India. But it needs all these factors that should be there for introducing this vaccination into our national immunization schedule. It requires strong political commitment, technical advisory group support, awareness initiatives, adequate resources, OD, transportation services, intersectoral coordination, positive attitude, print, and from good support from the media, committed immunization staff. All these things are required for this to come true. So please do recommend this vaccine. You tell the parents that almost everyone gets HPV, and HPV can cause a variety of cancers in women and men. And you have to remind the parents that HPV is for cancer prevention. It can protect against so many types of cancers. And you provide a strong recommendation for HPV vaccine when patients are 11 or 12 years old, because you will be getting highest immune response at this age group. And you listen carefully to them and welcome the patient and parent questions, especially about the safety of this vaccine. So with that, I conclude. Thank you for your patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Mia, for that extensive presentation on HPV vaccines and HPV infection per se. And a few things. So what is the protocol in for HPV vaccination for males?
Males, actually, in India, it has not been licensed. Whatever protocol is followed for females, it can be followed in males. So below 15 years, you require only 2 doses. And after 15 years, you can give 3, you need to give 3 doses. So that is what they practice in USA and all. In India?
And which is more preferable, this in especially in males, this trivalent or the quadrivalent?
We should give either quadrivalent vaccine or the nonavalent vaccines, the second generation vaccine. Because
is it available in India, nonavalent?
Nonavalent is not available in India. Only Gardasil is available in India. So if you want to vaccinate males, you have to give Gardasil. Cervarix, the problem is it is not acting against 6 and 11, which is the causative agent of genital warts. So you need to cover this also when you plan to vaccinate the male. So you need to give Gardasil at least.
And after this 0-2-6 regime, do we require any booster doses after that?
Whatever evidence is available as of now, no booster doses are needed. We don't know whether we require booster doses in the future. All those studies are ongoing only. Till now, we don't require any because the immunity has not waned over this much time. That is after 10 years of follow-up. It has remained stable only.
And those who have taken the Gardasil, that is quadrivalent vaccine, once when the this nine-valent vaccine is available, do they have to take that one?
No. Which vaccine you have taken, you have to follow the entire course of that same vaccine.
No, the course is finished. Course is finished, but the nonavalent will cover many other strains. That's what I understand, isn't it?
Yeah.
So
actually, there is no recommendation like that. What they are recommending is whatever vaccine you are taking as of now, whatever vaccine you are taking, you take that vaccine as the series. If you are not able to get the vaccine, you can take the nonavalent vaccine. It is acceptable. It's okay. The rest of the doses, you can complete with nonavalent vaccine. It's okay.
Just like we take Covishield this year, next year you take some RNA vaccine, and the year after that you take some DNA vaccine, because then only these many variants will be covered, isn't it? because so many variants will come for any type of viruses. Yeah. So I think no vaccine can be permanent, I believe, by all possibilities. Anyway, it's an excellent presentation by both of you, and it has really enlightened all the people who are watching through this Zoom platform as well as the virtual platform. And it was a really excellent, very good discussion. And thank you, Dr. Sajna and Dr. Emya, for that wonderful presentations once again. And thank you, the AstroMIMS Hospital, for supporting this today's academic event. And one reminder is that we will have a session on preeclampsia on Saturday, that is 22nd May at 7 p.m. And there will be a presentation by Dr. Suresh from Mediscan Chennai regarding the preeclampsia screening on that day, because that day is the preeclampsia awareness day. That's all. Thank you all. Thank you so much. With this, we wind up the program. Good night.